is get measurements for my fish as close as I can. This one's still a little froze. Freezer burn or something. But you want to measure him? From the, there's several measurements. The main measurements, according to, the main measurements will be according to what company you use. But a lot of times right here, at the back of this collarbone, or this all the way to the base of the tail, is one measurement. And I've got, and hold the fish as straight as possible. Looks like 11. Looks like about 11 1/4. Now that's the length. Now what I'll do, I'll make a bracket. I'll draw a fish. It's easier for me. And the taxidermy companies will have A times B times C. And a lot of times this is the A measurement from the end of the gill to the base of the tail. Not the end of the tail, but the base of the tail. So I messed that up. Okay, pull to the base of the tail. I had a 11 1/4. You just write down exactly what you see. And if you have to make alterations, like stretching him a little bit or something, do that after you get your actual measurements. Always write down your exact measurements, and then you can do all your stretching and stuff. Okay. Your form from that wants the end of the eye to the base of the tail, from the middle of the eye to the base of the tail. And I've got 15 1/2. Okay. Middle of the eye to the base of the tail, and I'll draw a little bar from the base of the tail to the middle of the eye, a little bracket coming out from the fish. Then I'll put that measurement, write that measurement down. Although I tend to use the back of the gill to the base of the tail in girth. And a lot of times there's the overall length. Some of them use the overall length and then just the girth. All companies require different measurements, so it's good to, sometimes it's good to cover your bases. If you don't know exactly the measurements from the company you're going to order your forms from, go ahead and get all these measurements. This is the total length from the end, from the base of the tail, or from the tip of the jaw, all the way to the base of the tail, or all the way to the end of the tail, and then you want to close the tail up. Get an accurate measurement. Okay. And then you write that measurement down. This is the total length from the end of the tail closed to the tip of the lower jaw of the mouth with it being closed. And then you get the girth. A lot of times I'll just write that out to the side. Just write the word girth. And then put equal sign on it. And you want to transfer these notes to your main paperwork, or go ahead and write it on your main paperwork. And that's probably even easier. Then you want to find the fattest part of the fish to get your girth measurement. Should be the belly. Okay. Okay, that was 14. So that was my thickest measurement at the thickest part of the belly. I had 14, so I'm going to write 14 now. Okay, I've got a fish with a that's going to be 14 inches thick. That's going to be his thick belly. What if your customer really wants the pot belly look? What they usually do, they'll sacrifice a little bit of length to give him a more bigger pot belly. In other words, he's got a 14 inch girth. Maybe I'll give him a 15 or even a 15 1/2 inch girth. Really fatten him up but I may have to lose a little bit of length. I'll lose about an inch of length. And so keep that in mind. The fatter a fish is, the shorter he is, but he looks better. He looks more fuller, and in a way, he'll look bigger. He'll look bigger and thicker. Measurements in mind. And whichever company that you plan on ordering your fish body from, make sure you know the measurements they want. And that way, you can order your right body. Just taking some notes here. But if you look, see how I drew the brackets? I guess that's what you call them. How they come out, okay, this is from the end of the lip to the very back of the tail. And that's for a measurement that may call, that's for a body that, or a taxidermy company that may require the total length. Now another company may require the base of the tail to the back of the gill. And that's a common measurement. So I've got little brackets made for that. And then I write the measurement in between that space on the brackets. And I've got another one from the middle of the eye to the base of the tail. A lot of companies call for that measurement. And I got a little space between the bracket for it. Okay, now the girth. I'll just write down my measurement below the girth or to the side of it. And usually the girth and then whatever other measurements it calls for are the main measurements. So that's how I do it. The side that was in the sand, that's the side that's you're gonna sew on. So you wanna go ahead and clip the fin on that side. That's the way I do it. Now I know which side is supposed to be sewed. To do, I've got my fish. Now the side I cut the fin on, the side that was laying on the sand, that's the side you want to cut. Is the side that. So now what I do is I get an X-Acto knife, and right here where the scales stop and the tail ends, I want to cut right up under the scale. Without going through the tail, and do it as good as you can. If you miss, you know, if you don't get it perfect, that's all right. And you can even use your other fingers as a guide, sort of. But as you can see, I'm cutting under the scale next to where the fin rays are. You do that all the way down to the bottom of the tail. All the way to the top and all the way to the bottom. And I think I've got it good enough. And I do. Now you come in with a pair of fish shears or a good pair of scissors. And what you want to do, go straight down the middle. Straight down the middle, which is basically the lateral line at the base of the tail, and you work your way up. Shears out there. But you go right up the middle. Till you get to that collarbone. You know that bone right there under the gill? I forget what they call it, the pleothrum or something like that. But you want to have a good pair of scissors to cut through that. So fish shears is a good thing to have. Pretty strong. What I've done is I've cut right down through here, the incision between the tail and the scales. I'm going to cut all the way down, then I'm going to cut all the way down through the skin, all the way up to this bone, and then I snip through the bone. Now that's what I've done so far. Okay, now you want to cut under skin. You want to have a good sharp blade too. It makes everything easier. But right where the gills end, your red gills on the inside, right where they end, and the thin skin meets, you want to make an incision. You may need to poke through the skin itself. Right here on the end of the gills, and where the skin meets, there's a thin flap of skin. You want to cut it off. But you, when you get to the bottom, you don't want to cut to the other side. You want to go as far as you can go and leave it for now. Explanatory right there. I cut through the bone, and there's thin skin right up under the gill plates. I got as close to the gills as I could. Cut around that way, and then I cut around that way. As close to the gills that I can get. Now I've got one of these knives. I guess you call it a skinning knife, I guess. It's just got a serrated edge. It's not sharp. Just serrated. It's good enough for separating the skin from the meat, and that's what we want to do. Separate the skin from the meat as good as possible. If you don't get it perfect, that's all right, because we're going to be doing a little fleshing later anyway. All the way as reasonably close to the skin as you possibly can. And you want to go all the way up until you feel your knife hit your fin rays, your bones of your fin rays that we haven't cut yet. When you feel your knife hit that, you know you've done good enough. So I can feel it rubbing against the bones of these rays that hadn't been cut yet. The spiny dorsal, I can feel the bones of the spiny dorsal where they hadn't been cut. And you do this side the same way. Just get it between the skin and the meat as good as possible. Another spot I should have cut. What we're cutting is that bottom collarbone.
I don't know if you can see it.
Collarbone, right here where the skin is, of the collarbone that needs to be cut, because if you don't reach in sideways and cut that collarbone, we'll never be able to separate all this. In other words, the bottom of the collarbone was still together, but I broke it. I cut it. Go back to your skin knife and get that a little bit better if you want to. But remember, we cut as close to the gill as possible for this reason right here. We can skin all this out, and if we use a form or a pack gun or anything, this skin's still intact at the bottom. Now we're going to go ahead and use our
fish shears
and start cutting our bones. Your bones. And you want to make sure you get under there. You might feel the bones crunching. And if you don't get them perfect, that's all right. We'll go back here in a little bit and get them again. We do the tail the same way. You can kind of feel those bones, and a lot of times you're able to get your shears right up under, and you just snip it off, like so forth. See how easy that was? little base of the tail and just start snipping off. And you do the spiny dorsal the same way. Fishing real big, a lot of times you go ahead and snip through the spine while you're up here. Saves from having to do it later, you know. And then you go back to this knife, start getting up under the skin. And you're done separating all the bony areas where they connect to the fish. Start bringing it apart like that. You know, within reason, as good as you can get it. Because we can always go back over it after we get the meat out and get it better. Get to the guts, you cut the guts off. The meat's cut enough, you can yank that meat out. Stuff, and I like to get borax. Just put it in there and kind of get rid of some of the wetness a little bit. Run around here some intestines and cut these intestines off. Now essentially all you're left with is meat. Get the meat off. All you do is start digging up under the meat. You don't want to go too far. You don't want to go through the scales. I mean, fish are fairly hardy, but sometimes they'll tear if you're not careful. So it's just something to think about. Coming off, kind of rolling it. clean that out. Using it the same way you'd use a fleshing knife. Same technique. The fleshing to help sturdy the skin a little bit. And I suppose it could help you from losing the scale every now and then. Starting point and start scraping it off. On the anus. Yeah, I usually just go one way like this, but for camera purposes, once you'd be able to see it, I'm doing it this way. Good. Get as much out as you can, even from the top. Even the top of the fish, you can get it to come out. You know, more power to you. Close to the bones as I can, because there's a lot of meat right there at the base of the bones. And so I'll tend to try to get that out so I don't have to go worry about going back and getting it next time. And that's on both sides. A lot of times it'll just peel off. You know, this is only on the back side now. I mean, you don't even have to have the fin on the other side because nobody sees it anyway. And a little bit of bone above this fin joint too, I guess you could cut it also.
Well, you probably can't get a real good view of it.
And these are those bottom fins on the very bottom. The pelvic fins, this is the base of the pelvic fins. And a lot of times there's meat around them too. Sometimes you can get pretty close cutting that bone off there. That's about where I need to be. So this is all coming up. A little bit to help you out. Clip it on the skin. And you don't have to use a blade every time. In certain areas you can. Okay. Now what I've done is I've took that bone out all in here. There's no bone in there. On this side either. On both sides. You can get a little bit more thorax in there. Now, then when you're sure you got it all pretty darn clean, I need to get a little bit more of that bone out. I push it down a little bit more, right here on the edge, and we can go. A little bit more bone out. This is under the throat area. Sometimes there's excess meat down there that can come off. You may want to run your scissors up on the top of the head. A lot of times there's a little bit of a spinal cord sort of like up above the head. Now right above the throat area, you can see the throat where the meat part is on the throat. Right up above that area is the bone. I get as far back as I can and I break it. Then I grab the bone and twist. And that's what's left of our spinal cord. Go up there and cut in different directions. And hopefully do so without ruining the fish. There's the brain pan is in there. All kinds of skull cartilage in there from around the eyes and all kinds of stuff in there. So here's the throat area. You can see the throat. Above the throat was all that bone. And I cut a lot of it out with a pair of shears. And then you can go back in with just a pair of these hemostats. And get a lot of the excess will come right out. Some of it's still attached by membranes and what have you. But stuff that's like meat and stuff, it'll come out. Okay, that kind of basically told me what I got. And in here, I'm going to snip all this meat, get around all this meat, and snip it if I can. That's the top of the head, once on the side, once from underneath where the throat is. I'm going to try to get all that stuff out. Helps you where you can work on it. You see little bits of meat that can come up. connected here and there. All the brain pan area. Okay, when you're sure you got that out good, you go ahead and go back to this and clean out anything you think you need to get cleaned out. A lot of times around the intestines or right where the anal opening is, there's a lot of like a cartilaginous type of meat. It's not quite meat, but it's almost like cartilage or something. That, you want that to come off too if you can get it. Strong fish ears. When we grab the fin, as close to the body as you can, without actually cutting through. The closer you can get without cutting through, the better off it's going to be. Sometimes I accidentally cut through. That's no big deal, you know, cut through a little bit. I went and got that. And you want to do the same on these. You get back as far as you can. Snip. You may even snip some of the bone off if you want to. Here, you want to do the same thing. I have a tendency to want to turn the fish over like this. And I grab that old spiny dorsum. I get as close to the front as I can get with that. Sometimes I get almost too close. You want to push up the fin as high as it'll go, and you kind of push on it. And what with this finger, push up on it where you get as much of the bone as you can out. I'm going to go back later and cut the meat out as good as we can. Okay, I see a little meat that'll come out, so I'm going to go ahead and cut it out. Make sure you get all that stuff in the head that'll come out. You want it all to come out. If it'll come out, it needs to come. Okay, this tail area, you might want to trim that up a little, or the pectoral fin area, I'm sorry. Might want to trim it up as close as you can get it. You can put a hole there too. But I'll show you how to fix that too later on in the mounting process, if you do put a hole in it. Clean good enough. Then we're going to move on to the eyes. Here at the eye, I've got my X-Acto knife. in between the eye and the corner of the eye, I guess you could say the cartilage. You go right down the side of the eye and you'll feel a little bit of skin. But you want to cut that all the way around. And cut it all the way around. And it helps have a good sharp knife to do it right. And after you think you've got it good enough to at least be able to pull it out, and you grab your hemos again, cut off, do this eye the same way. Now what you want to do is run. Now what you want to do is run. Go inside the cheek area, and you'll cut above the meat, and then you loop around. Try to cut below the meat. You'll feel a bone below the meat. Sometimes you can feel that bone below the meat. And you just kind of try to work on getting that meat out. Then you use the hemostats, which are an invaluable tool for this. Below the cheek. All the way to the end. What you're doing basically separating the skin from the cheek meat with a knife. If it's good and sharp, it'll do a good job. If it's not sharp, it won't do a good job. Then you go in with the hemostat. Pull out that meat. I don't worry so much around this area. Because a lot of that is just like white streams or something. But I definitely want to get out of the cheek area. You want to get all that meat out. If you don't get the meat out, when you put the machete in, when you build your cheeks up with the machete, where the meat's at will just shrink down to nothing. Because the meat shrinks down to nothing. But, and then there's no machete there, and you have a big wrinkle there. And it looks pretty bad if you don't do it right. It looks real bad if you don't do it right, actually. Okay, then what you do is you get some water, and I've got some water. Borax, where when I mix it in, then it doesn't build up on the bottom. Or a better way to say it is, if it starts building up on the bottom, you know, after you've saturated the water real good, then that means you put enough borax in it. And it's real easy to waste and put more than what you need to do. I've got a bucket with a little bit of water up to about here. And I've been putting borax in it, just pouring it in, straight like that. And here again, it's better to have too much and not enough. But if it starts building up on the bottom, you know you've got enough in there. It doesn't take much. We need to go back and get some of the meat off after it's been preserved. But I saturated the water and it started building up on the bottom, so I know I saturated the water good enough. Now you let it sit A lot of people like to wait 2 or 3 days, but at least 14 hours. We're going to be mounting a walleye in this particular case, but it just as easily could have been a bass. If you've got your fish in preservative, I go ahead and put him in some clear water or rinse him off under a sink or something. Or even get a bucket with clear water in it. It's clear tap water. And there'll be bits of borax on the fish. And you can usually feel it. You want to try to get that stuff off. You know, if you put a little bit... Sometimes the borax will get on the body. You just got to get it off. They're like little chips. And they'll come off relatively easy. Especially if you've got a big bucket worth of clear water. This takes a few minutes. Sometimes the fin on the side that's facing the wall, you can cut those fins off because they're not going to show anyway. And spread it out, and I'll show you what we do. You can use these for spare fins if you get a fish with a damaged fin. You can actually have a drawer just for fins. But what you can do, you can spread it out like this. Here, I'll show you. You can just spread it out on your wall. Or I guess on a piece of cardboard. Now this fin, it preserves with your fish in the borax and water solution. And it'll stay there until it dries. All I did was spread the fin out. All I did was spread the fin, put it on the wall, and it'll dry like that. And then when it dries, you just peel it off and you can use it for other things. You can use it for repair work on another fish. And I've even used them on artificial replicas to give the fish more realistic look. Okay, what I've done is I've got a commercial body that I ordered using my measurements. The main measurements being the... Depending on the which body, where you order your body, some of them do just from the end of the, just the total length of the fish, the mouth all the way to the end of the tail, from the tip of the mouth to the end of the tail. But a majority of them, from behind the gill, right there at that collarbone, the cleothrum or whatever they call it, to the end of the tail where the scales stop on your tail and where your fin rays begin on your tail. So right there at the base of your tail, you know where your fin rays start. Right there at the base of your tail where your fin rays start. And from here, from the collarbone all the way to the base of the tail. And your girth at its thickest point. You get those two measurements. Those are your two main measurements. Depending on your form. And a lot of times when I mount a fish, a lot of times I'll end up cutting this off. Putting clay up in here or up into the head. Depending on how good you get your head. There's even a piece of a cartilage that separates one eye from the other. A lot of, like a thin piece of cartilage. Some if you take all that cartilage out and stuff, this will stick up in there a lot farther. But a lot of times on my bass even, I'll tend to cut that off. But I have left it before. It's just how good it mounts. So what we're going to do now, I pulled it out of the water. Now I got the water close by so I can put it back in the water if I need to. And now's a good time to do any preliminary fleshing if you need to. And there's no doubt this is going to fit. This form is going to fit. All you have to look at it as. And that's going to fit good, but we got some empty places in here. are going to need some clay. So I keep that in mind. Put my fish back in the water. And then I go ahead and get my clay. Four bodies, right here where you want the front of your fin to be and the back of your fin to be. A lot of times people put a little bead of clay there. A bead of clay around the back of the tail, and even a bead of clay up here. But some of the forms nowadays are so good you don't really have to do all that. So it's something else to keep in mind. Good. I don't have to do any cutting or anything on it. I gave it a little bit more of a belly. In other words, I ordered a form. If you get a fish that's spawned out, to make the customer happy, bigger is always better. That's a good rule of thumb. Just remember that. Because sometimes the fish may tend to look a little bit littler to them on the wall anyway. But a lot of times, now right in here I could feel this, I could feel this gap. I could cut it off. Usually, most of the time I'll cut this off and just have clay up in the head. But this time I'm not going to do it. Could it fit up in there so good? But usually I'll cut this off and on the mount, the head of the fish will have clay in it. That if you want to use clay on them. Some of the ridges out before you put it on the mount. You can put clay in these juncture areas, but this form is so good. If there's little ridges that pop up, just like on a deer head or something, you know, where the mold made the form, go ahead and use sandpaper. Sand off them little ridges. You don't want them to show through on your mount. Now, I'm kind of positioning the head. And that little arm that's coming out on the top of the form, that little extension, it's going right up into the brain pan area. All that brain pan cartilage and all that stuff up in there, we moved. We took it off. And we want that to stay. So we just mashed the form up into where the brain was. And that's in there pretty good. It's in there pretty good. Over the bottom. Right there where we end up skinning out. A lot of times we'll put a couple staples in there just to go ahead and hold it now. That head looks pretty good. You know, we can lift it up later using whatever means we need to. But on this side, where we skin him out, we want our bottom fins to line up as close as possible. And they do. We want all this to be where it's supposed to be. Just like when we skin it out. We want it to go. And the simple thing to use is just a staple. In the olden days, they used to sew the skin up, and that's fine, but to me, just stapling is so much easier. It's unbelievable how much easier it is. And I'm lining up the anatomy of the fish. That's the only thing I'm doing, lining up the anatomy of the fish. I know where the belly goes. The belly tapers off here, and then the front of the fin there. The back of the fin goes right here. and the belly goes right there. So I'm lining up the anatomy of my fish. I know where everything goes. Pin in or even just a staple. Problem on, especially on one that you're going to, it's going to be a tight fit. A lot of times when you do the belly first, you'll end up with the skin folded over too much on the top. So there's a balancing act. Depending on how tight your form is, you want everything to line up. You want the fins to line up. And with these artificial bodies, guess where it's taken out? Okay, there's the base of the tail fin. And it's right where it needs to be. And somewhere kind of down in the back where it's not noticeable, put a staple to hold it. And even up here, you want all this to line up to be good and round. So you need to lay the fish straight down. All this looks good and lined up to me. There's an area where these fins go. And you can tell when they're lined up. You can sure tell it. We'll go back later and put a good healthy row of scales. Just make sure the skin dries the way it needs to dry. And this is going to be a beautiful fit. You carefully lay the fish down without damaging fins and line up everything else the way you know it needs to be lined up. Once you get the fins lined up fairly close where you think they need to be, pop the staple in. Okay, now we've got just a few staples just to hold the skin roughly where we need to. You're right here around the tail, you can put a little clay back here in the junction area. And you want this level for a good looking mount. Make sure you got all your meat out and everything. You want the top of the tail to go with the top of the form. And it is. And the bottom of your tail to go with the bottom of the form. And you put a staple, you can put one to hold both sides. Just hold it temporarily. Now what we're going to do now is put it on a stick so we can do the rest of our mounting work. Now you can use a vice grip or whatever. Whatever else you want to use. Here I'm using a little bench mounting deer head stand. It works good. They use for concrete work. These will work fine for that. Might even want to get you a couple of long screws. That's one. Now these gray stakes are mounting sticks. I've used these over and over and over. And I've even put holes where the thing that sticks up. I've already got holes set where I've used them so many times on other fish. But as you can see, you know, there's a block of wood that's already in the form. So all you got to do is hit that. And cinch down real good. And make sure you're good and level. Now we're going to go ahead and run more staples in the back and straighten everything up. Okay, now you can see probably where we put some of our old staples. But now what we're doing, we're just wanting to staple the skin up as high up as it'll go. And just to help hold it while it dries. Which is not going to be a bad problem anyway. This is a pretty good fit. I've also noticed the walleye tail down, I like the tail down better than the tail up. It looks better for some reason. It really does. It stands out to me. Then again, that's a personal preference. But you can see how I'm going down and making sure it's good and tight and down as far as it can go. So I have sewn on occasion, especially on my gar. If I carve a body, they're such tough skin. A gar with such a tough skin, the animal, I couldn't get a staple to go through the scales. Using a fish paste or silicone or something like that. Now I've used silicone on carved bodies, and the good thing about that silicone, where it stays after you put it, it's going to stay. It doesn't shrink like caulking, like latex caulk and some of the other stuff you can use. So it has its benefits. And pin the fins. What you want to do, preferably if you can get in on the back, it's less repair work that you have to make. But you go down, get behind that first spine, and you want to be able to lift all this up. Like so forth. And sometimes it's better to go behind the second one. Now if it's a tight fit, it might be a little harder than at other times to do this. But don't let it fret you, that's normal. It's normal for a tight fit, is what I should say. So when you run into it, don't be shocked. Worry so much about going in from the back, because the hole is so minute. It doesn't really show all that much anyway. But the main thing, you want the fins as up as high as possible as you can get them. Because the only thing holding them up from flopping, from folding back down, is the strength of the T-pin you're using. So there again, you may want to use a T-pin that's got a little bit of strength. The catalogs probably have about the best ones you can get anywhere. The taxidermy catalogs. make sure we cover them with something so they don't dry and get all crooked. You want them to dry, but you don't want them to dry crookedly. That's what I'm saying. Make sure your fins are lined up with your areas on your mount. Prey that comes out, sometimes you want to kind of estimate how you want it spread. Yeah, about like that. About right. It is possible to overdo stuff like this too. You can go in from the front too, you'll just have to cover up your hole later. Okay, you want to make sure you have a good point on the end of your fins. And anatomically, you already kind of know how they go, so you just want to replicate that. And then you do the other one the same way. I'll use a thinner diameter pin basically because that's all I need. That's the only reason. But I'll get about to the, almost to the last spiny ray up here, and then I'll jab a pin through, like so forth. And you don't want the fin to stick to the body. On the mount, you don't want it to do that either. Now I get another one and go right about to the bottom. Now going like so forth. And then you can determine how far you want the fin out. And I want it about like that. So you want to put one to the bottom. Yeah, nothing looks worse than a fin that's not spread out. Rather quickly doing this, not real quickly, but if your fins start to dry out, you might want to just spray them with an atomizer bottle. In other words, just a regular squirt bottle, just to keep fins from drying out. Put as much of these as you need to hold everything the way you think that you need to have it held. And as good as you think it needs to be held. You can even use clothes pins. Clothes pins will work. To get you some screening material, you can buy this in Walmart in the craft section. They come out, they're just like plastic sheeting with little squares in them. And what you'll do, you'll trace the fin with a marker, get your Sharpie pin, trace the outline of your fin, and cut it out with a pair of scissors. Cut out one for the front and one for the back. And use the one as a template and go ahead and make you one for the, make you a second one. First, first one with a Sharpie pen, cut it out and use it as a template. Pulled up good. And then anchor it by either a clothespin or a paper clip. Pin to work. Okay, and we use that as a template. Now these fins are pre-cut, in other words, I use these on a bigger fish. Okay, now I made a template. This one will go in the front. And then I'll make one for the back. And all you gotta do is just cut it like so forth. Make sure your spines are pulled up like how you want them. Squeeze tight so your spines don't go back down. And then run you either a clothespin or some other means of clamping device. And you do all the fins that way. Basically what I've done, I've used these on other fish, but they'll work on this fish. So I go ahead and keep that in mind. So I'll use them again. Down real good how you think you want the fins to be, throw your paper clip on there. And it's that simple. A lot of this stuff isn't hard, it's just a series of steps and proper technique. Think of carding material and scheme of things, I think the gradient of the head looks pretty good, but the lower jaw, I thought it was it needs to go up a little. Was run a little pin up through here. And up into the roof of the mouth. Now if you're like me, chances are you've got something already cut out that'll work. And it just happens to be that I do. So that works out pretty good. Don't have to deal with cutting or nothing. That's why you always save, because if you mount a bunch of walleye, you'll end up using probably the exact things you mounted the walleyes with, your previous walleyes. And you don't have to worry about cutting more stuff out. I mean, Save your stuff from your earlier fish, in other words, that's what I'm trying to say. Cleaning all the time, you just reuse what you want and if need be, whittle down what you got. The stuff's not expensive at Walmart anyway, but if you save it, it'll at least keep you from having to do some cutting. Side the same way. Make sure you don't get no gills by accident. You don't want to get none of your gills. You just want to get your gill raker or your gill flap, the outer extremity. You don't want to get your actual gills caught up in this screening. So you'll have to look in to make sure you don't accidentally, you know, nab some of your gills by accident. Trying to fish however you need to have the head. Sometimes you'll have, you know, to elevate the head, you'll have to use some kind of big long nail or some kind of rod or metal wire. And I have even used screwdrivers before, but you'll jab it down in here and get into the styrofoam, and you elevate the head however you want it. You just tap it in with a hammer until it dries. At least until it dries good enough where you can pull it out and it will stay a few days anyway. I'm going to separate the gills. The gills inside here, if you don't separate them, it don't look good. It's just a big clump of red flesh. So it's, and you can use foam or anything just to separate the gills, but you don't want them too wide. You don't want the gills flared out on this thing, you know, make it look like a toad or something. You don't want to do that. It's real easy to over-inflate the gills and make them stick out too far, so you want to be careful with that. You just want them separated. I have looked up in there and seen them naturally separated and not have to worry, but most of the time you have to separate them. Try and leave it well enough alone, but if you got to elevate it or space it or prop it, then you need to do it. They're good and separated. And you can either go in from the front or the back, either one, whichever, I suppose whichever one's easiest. What I'm doing, I just cut up a popsicle stick and I'm using two of them. Piece is about a half inch long, and hopefully that won't space it too far apart, the gills, I mean it still could. I don't want it to, and I don't want it flared up like a toad, in other words. You know, it's possible to over inflate the gills, and that's not a welcome sight. That was pretty good like that. Just one separated. That's all we're after is separation. Nothing more. That's pretty good and separated. And of course you do the other side the same way. Okay, now what I did, I got a little bit of cellulose insulation. All it is finely cut up newspaper, and they use it for insulation. And I've got a little bit of molding plaster. This is plaster of Paris, but it dries a little fast. They got some other stuff out there that's pretty good. Now, if you use a container that has had borax in it or something, like this one has, be careful because borax will slow down the setting time. So if at all possible, make sure you've got a good container. Then when you mix this mishay up, you don't want it real soupy. You want it a little bit where it's a little thick, but at the same time you don't want it as water. So that's the viscosity you want. You don't want it like soup, but you want it nothing more. It's pretty good to separate. Then of course you do the other side the same way. Okay, now what I did, I got a little bit of cellulose insulation. All it is is finely cut up newspaper, and they use it for insulation. Now I've got a little bit of molding plaster. This is plaster of Paris, but it dries a little fast. They got some other stuff out there that's pretty good. Now if you use a container that has borax in it or something, like this one has, be careful because borax will slow down the setting time. So if at all possible, make sure you've got a good container. Then when you mix this mishay up, you don't want it real soupy. You want it a little bit where it's a little thick, but at the same time you don't want it as water. So that's the viscosity you want. You don't want it like soup, but you want it but you don't want it so thick that you can't work with it. So you have to find a good little medium there. And what we're going to do is fill the cheek pockets up. And all I'm doing is mixing it together. And it'll set. It'll start getting kind of warm and start setting up. Not any different than Bondo or any other kind of thing like that. Now it's real important that you fill these cheek pockets up, because if you don't, they'll dry and cave in. And I've had people say that their mount would have been a good mount except for that. You've got to fill the cheek pockets up. And here again, you got to be careful. You don't want to fill them too full. Because if you fill them too full, you'll get the frog look again. Nothing against frogs, but that's not what we want. And if you do accidentally overfill it, you should still have time enough to squeeze it back out. Just make sure you're getting it all in there. So you want it thin enough where it'll get down in those cheeks real good. And that's what you want. And if anything, you can push the excess back out. I try not to be real messy with it, if I can keep from it. Although accidents do happen. And this is about as full as I want to get it. And then some. Matter of fact, if you want it, yeah, that's good and full. That's what you want. And here again, we're trying to avoid the frog look. I probably could have put less. But here again, at least I made sure that I had enough in there. Which is better than the alternative. Then you go ahead and do the same to the other side. And to make sure it's in that cheek. You can use a tucking tool or anything just to make sure that gets down in there. Nothing worse than having an empty spot in here, because after the fish dries, you'll have a big dent. And on the tinny method, it's hard to correct that kind of stuff. Because you're going to have to repaint in the detail. And it's just a a lot less headache if you see what's going to happen ahead of time, which I mentioned earlier. A lot of times you can see stuff, you know, after you've done them for just a little bit, you'll be able to foresee accidents before they happen. And you learn from your mistakes, in other words. And that's one mistake that you'll learn from, is to not leave an empty spot in the cheek, because it will show up. And you can make artificial rocks and anything out of it. They'll roll it together and just kind of lightly plop it on the ground and make rocks and stuff like that out of it. There's all kinds of things. You could even pack it behind the throat area if you wanted to, but the main thing is you don't have to waste it. Although it's not real expensive either. And the same is true with your epoxy sculpt. If you have leftover epoxy from a fish or a deer or something, you can make little things like mushrooms out of them and use them on your next habitat scene. And when you're happy with the anatomy of the fish, you go ahead and just take it off. And hang it up to dry. Now the fish is dry, and what you want to do is, when you take these screens off, screen material off, you just want to be careful that you don't accidentally tear the fin somehow. Now you don't want to put the fin in a bind. It's better to be safe than sorry. You just want to operate a little bit of care. And you can even take the pins out. You may want to take the screening out first, then your pins. And you just want to be careful. And you know, when you think you can just yank the screening off, and sometimes you tear a little bit of the fin that way. So you just want to exercise just a little bit of caution while you're doing it. You just want to make sure all your clips are off. And if you're in a position where you think, sometimes you think you can just yank it off, but sometimes you do accidentally tear the fin, so you just have to exercise caution. And you do all of your fins this way. I just did it on the inside. Usually the clips don't show so bad on the outside. They don't show anywhere where the scales are. And you just take it out. Real careful with it. I've already done. All I did was, in this case, I used an old cigarette carton box, and it seems to be pretty good cardboard. But they've got other stuff on the market that you can buy from the taxidermy company. You can buy some clear stuff, and there's just so many different ways. But all I did was put the cardboard behind the tail, trace out the tail reasonably close as possible, and I did all my fins that way. And now what I'm going to do is I'm going to put a coat of glue on this before I even cut it out. I like to put glue on it, because if you cut them out and put glue on them or contact cement on them, it seems like they won't stick to your hands or fall on the floor, or it's hard to get them to let go of your fingers because the glue sticks to your fingers. So I go ahead and glue them while they're still connected, and then I just cut them out after they're already got a coat of glue over it. And I put one on this, I put one coat on the cardboard, and I put one coat on the back of the fins. And you can even put two on the cardboard and two on the back of the fins, and let it dry for about, let it get semi-dry where it gets tacky, and then you just touch them together and it connects and stays. What I've got now is a good contact cement. They've got some bad stuff on the market. And you just want to put a coat on the back of the fin that you're going to card. Make sure you get a good coat on there. And one should be sufficient. You do it to all your fins. Just one good healthy coat of contact cement. And like I said, you can even let it dry and go back over with another coat. Usually once on this and once on the fin and once on the cardboard, a lot of times that's been good enough for me. I've had no problems with it adhering real good. You know, as long as you use a good contact cement, you shouldn't have a problem, in other words. A lot of stuff for backing the fins. They got fin backing cream they've got we'd want to use. Now, if a fin's in real good shape, like on the body or something, or on the side of the body, or even the bottom fins, a lot of times if they're in real good shape, I'll leave them alone because they add some transparency to the mount. You know, the fins, if they're a little transparent. A lot of times you can put a little pearl on there, you know, and then mist a little bit of green on there, and it makes for a real dynamic looking mount if the fins are a little bit transparent. Adds to the realism of it. But if they're damaged, just don't fret it any and go ahead and card them. Outline the stuff on. Put a coat on here like this. Just make sure you get it everywhere on the tail. And make sure you use a good contact cement. There's some stuff out there that doesn't even work. Carded it. Now what I'm going to do is I'm just going to lay it down, let it dry. And this contact cement doesn't take long. And you want to follow what you outlined. And depending on how good you outlined, if you loosely outline, that's okay as long as, you know, you can always trim the cardboard off with a razor later, which is what we're going to do. So now we're just cutting out. You know, just like you did when you were in elementary school, just cutting stuff out. And that's all we're doing. Outline of the fin that has its glue already on it. Connect them together, because once you connect them, that's pretty much all she wrote. They're there for the count. So you want to be as careful as you can. This bass, and then a razor blade, and do any, you know, finite trimming with the razor blade. And dry, you just go through and... Now if you were doing this by yourself, you might hold it by the stick where you can burn the fish and get at it any way that you need to. Now that's good, but remember we're going to go back with a razor to do our final trimming. This is just to get the bulk. Maybe of the cardboard that we left. Edges where there's supposed to be a curve. You don't want no sharp edges. I'm trimming. And what you want to do, you just want to run it flush up against the fin. Maybe even a little bit at a little bit behind the fin. You know, at a downward angle behind the fin will ensure that you get the cardboard off where it's not going to show from the front. Just like that. You can ensure that at least you cut the cardboard where it won't show from the front. This probably isn't the best example, because this fin is in pretty good shape. But you can see a little bit of a torn area there. Now imagine this being even worse. You know, maybe even part of the fin off. A little bit of caulk, latex caulk. And get you a little bit of water. Maybe put it on the brush. You want to thin it down. Maybe want to bring it this way a little bit. Now what you're doing, you're ending up making, if it was a big tear, see the brush itself, the bristles of the brush will actually make your fin raise. Brush and get a little bit of water. with the brush.